Your Excellence, distinguished colleagues, ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. I'm James Davison Hunter. I'm the LaBrosse Levinson Professor of Religion, Culture, and Social Theory and the Executive Director of the Institute for Advanced Studies in Culture. On behalf of the Institute, as well as our co-sponsors, the Department of Politics, the Virginia Center for the Study of Religion, and the Nelson Lectures on Southeast Asia, I want to welcome you all to this special lecture on democratization in Indonesia, the world's most populous Muslim nation. If you go to Thomas Jefferson's home, Monticello, and most of you who are local have, it's just outside of town. And as you wend your way to his gravesite, you will note that Jefferson had engraved on his monument what he considered his three greatest achievements in life. The first was the drafting of the Virginia Statute for Religious Freedom. The second was the Declaration of Independence, religion and politics. Religion, of course, concerns the sacred, those things that we cherish above all, that which we worship, matters that are, by and large, non-negotiable, finally, because they reflect and embody our highest ideals of the true, the good, and the beautiful. Politics deals most basically with matters of power in the ordering of social life. At its best, it is the way power is used to establish justice and benevolence. Needless to say, each of these realms of activity, separately and together, have long been arenas of controversy, conflict, and all too often physical and symbolic brutality, precisely because they concern matters basic to human existence. Jefferson clearly understood these dynamics and felt the burden of history to articulate a new and different future, even while drawing on the resources of the past. In his context, the Virginia Statute for Religious Freedom and the Declaration of Independence were revolutionary innovations designed to increase the possibility of human flourishing. Into this mix, we see the significance of his third great achievement, the founding of the University of Virginia. Jefferson recognized that the world would continue to change and that it was essential to make sense of its complexity and engage it with imagination and courage. This task would require open reflection, inquiry, experimentation and debate, subjecting ideas and arguments to rigorous public scrutiny, all toward the end of addressing long-standing problems, challenging old ideas and establishing new paradigms of thinking and understanding. Indeed, nearly two centuries later, we find ourselves in a social setting that would have been unrecognizable to Jefferson. However, the tangle of controversy surrounding religion and politics would have been all too familiar and all the more appalling because at the start of the 21st century, dissension, conflict, and violence rooted at the intersection of power and the sacred have become technologized and globalized. Though the form of these problems are very old, the new social, economic, and technological challenges of the 21st century means that we have to work through them afresh. Clearly, these are dangerous times. What is at stake? It is not just a question of how we live together with our deepest differences without killing each other. It is also a question of how a just and humane social and political order can be generated, cultivated, nourished, and sustained in a time as complex and deeply diverse as ours. The answers are not obvious, and clearly much is at stake in how we navigate a way forward. This great university was founded by a man who understood exactly what was at stake in these incendiary arenas and gave his considerable talents to addressing them for his own generation. Taking on that Jeffersonian burden for our time and in our circumstances is one of the animating ideals of the Institute and why we are pleased to have Ambassador Jakob Tobing with us to address these important matters. Ambassador Tobing is currently the president of the Lamina Institute in Jakarta, Indonesia. He comes to this position in the wake of a long and distinguished career in Indonesian politics. He was the longest-serving member of the Indonesian Parliament, faithfully serving the people of Indonesia for 34 years. He then represented his country as the ambassador to the Republic of South Korea, where, for his service, he was awarded the Ganghwa Medal, the Republic of Korea's highest diplomatic award. Ambassador Tobing then served as the chairman of the ad hoc committee for the amendment of the Indonesian 1945 Constitution, and was also the chairman of the Indonesian general election in 1999, which oversaw the first democratic election in Indonesia in 32 years. For this work, Ambassador Tobing is considered Indonesia's second founding father. At a time when the fate of democracy against a rising tide of authoritarianism is a concern of many around the world, today's lecture has special significance. Could there be a more fitting place than Jefferson's Rotunda to glean lessons from Indonesia's own transformation from authoritarianism to democracy for our complex and troubled world? Please join me in welcoming Ambassador Jakob Tobing. Thank you.
Thank you. Good afternoon, distinguished ladies and gentlemen. First of all, I would like to thank Professor James Davison Hunter and the Institute for Advanced Studies in Culture for inviting me. It is an honor to have this opportunity in this impressive and famous Thomas Jefferson Rotunda of Virginia University. This is a well-known and famous names and universities in Indonesia. Indonesia successfully reformed our 95 constitution in a democratic and constitutional way through a seriatim 4 years process, which was conducted by the People Consultative Assembly from the year 1999 to the year 2002. It was a peaceful and democratic process. Both the desirable attributes for a new political system after transition from authoritarian regime, which are democracy and rule of law, have been incorporated into this constitution. And the whole process was consensual and gradual, quite different to the normal process usually discussed or recommended in various literatures. The sum of the characteristic, as Donald Horowitz says, of the process is what stamps Indonesia as distinctive, if not unique. During the process, only one out of almost 200 changes that made, and of all other proposal that was canceled, was taken by deliberative, by consensus, only one by voting. The process was completed in 2002, and now it's a working democracy. If you maybe heard about the situation in Jakarta in this last couple days, hundreds of thousands of people protested, demonstrated in capital city toward what they call as blasphemy, and it was ended in peaceful way. So it is, we regard it as a test to our democratic system. Some of people tried to manipulate, overriding this demonstration in order to ruin the new system, our democratic system, to return to the old authoritarian system. But yeah, thanks Lord, it's they cannot do that. This Indonesia the largest Muslim population country in the world is now the third largest working democracy after India and United States. Whereas until the last century, we were the second largest non-democracy. Yet, at least initially, not everyone could comprehend the significant changes that had occurred. The way we did the changes without academic draft and used the old constitution, the one that to be revised, as the working manuscript. Gradually, piece by piece, not in one shot, through deliberation and consensus, and solely by the Constituted Assembly, had invited and critics and sometimes funny comments. For instance, improperly, United Nations Commission on Human Rights Special Rapporteur, Datuk Param Kamaraswamy, reported that the piecemeal amendments that we are doing fail to meet the aspiration of the people for a democratic country under the rule of law. Recklessly, he reported that there is no constitutional provision expressly guaranteeing the independence of the judiciary, and there is also no express constitutional provision guaranteeing the right to a fair trial, which is there in our constitution. Donald Horowitz, one of the famous scholars in Indonesia, concludes that the Indonesian course, I mean American scholars, that Indonesian course was deviant in several respects and might have broken something like standard operating procedures regarding the sequence of democratic change, if like there is some standard procedures for that. And Tom Ginsburg writes that, according to conventional wisdom, Indonesia did everything wrong, but nevertheless managed to produce a vibrant constitutional democracy. But Alfred Stepan says that the big country that democratization theorists are watching most closely is Indonesia. And Miriam Kunkler and Alfred Stepan write that this world's most Muslim majority country strikes most observers as a democratization miracle. And to understand better the democratization process of the Constitution, it is helpful to look briefly at the background surrounding the birth of the original 95 Constitution and the nature of Indonesian politics. The reform of the Constitution was not a work of magic, nor a transplantation of ready-to-copy-paste formulas of democratic concept from literatures or other resources into the prevailing constitution. Rather, it was an ability to comprehend Indonesian socio-political and socio-cultural development along the history and to seize the opportunities opened by the political crisis at the end of the 1990s and to implement deliberative and consensual approach in achieving the expected reforms. The draft of our original constitution was made by a Japanese military administration founded investigating commission in May to July 1945 during the World War II. As also done in Burma and Philippines in 1943, the Japanese Empire planned to give independence to Indonesia on September 7, 1945, as a member of Japanese geopolitical ambitious project, the Greater East Asia Co-Prosperity Sphere, with the Japanese Empire as the leader. So in the eyes of the Japanese, the Second World War is not just a war about the resources That's the ideological war between fascism, communism, and capitalism. And we would like to be there, part of this ambitious project. By design, the political system built by the original constitution was an authoritarian system. In accordance with the integralistic concept adopted by this constitution, the system did not implement the principles of checks and balances, did not recognize election as an instrument of circulation of power, did not assert the independence of judiciary, and denied human rights. At the top of the system, there was a supreme state institution with unlimited authority, the People Consultative Assembly, which implemented people's sovereignty in full. This supreme institution had, among others, authority to elect the president and to ask accountabilities from all other state institutions, including the president, the parliament, and the Supreme Court. Originally, the system was based on a single state political party system which dominated the assembly. Later, after the Japanese surrendered under the pressure of the wind light forces, this plan was canceled and replaced by a multi-party parliamentary system, but still by using the old constitution. However, its preamble that was drafted by the prominent figures of Indonesian national movement for independence, the figures like Sukarno, our first president who visited Rotunda and spoke here 60 years ago in 1956, and Hatta, our prominent first vice president, they did it behind the back of Japanese authority and free from Japanese interventions. These preambles contain principles that are pro-humanity, people's sovereignty, justice and social welfare, and other principles that are contrary to fascism. It contains, among others, our state foundation, the Pancasila, the five principles, which are the first one, belief in oneness of God the Almighty, or sometimes it's called as belief in the one and only God, or maybe we can say in God we trust. The second is just and civilized humanity. The third is the unity of Indonesia. Fourth, democracy, guided by the inner wisdom in the unanimity arising out of deliberation amongst representatives. And the fifth, social justice for all the people of Indonesia. Thus then, the original constitution consists of two parts, the preamble and the articles, that are not matching with each other. Eventually, the constitution was ratified by a new independent preparatory after Indonesia gained independence, after we proclaimed our independence after the Japanese defeated. This immediately, in the boiling revolutionary atmosphere of the proclamation of independence and the following war to defend our independence when the Dutch attempted to occupy Indonesia again, this constitution, despite of its shortcomings, became a revolutionary constitution, a symbol of victory of the struggle for independence. It became a respected and to some extent a mythical and sacrosanct constitution, the untouchable. On the other hand, based on Pancasila, the constitution affirms that Indonesia is not a confessional state nor a secular state. These are the important factors that should be considered in rewriting or making changes to the original constitution. It would be different if the constitution in question is a hated or an imposed constitution. During Sukarno's era, when this constitution was prevailing, that's from 1959 to 1966, he tried to control the assembly by uniting the nationalists, the religious, and the communists under his control, but to no avail. Subsequently, with full support from the military, Suharto managed, the second president, to control the political parties, reducing its numbers from around 20 political parties to two political parties and one dominating functional group's political power, so three legs. And thus, he can control the assembly, and then there he was in power for more than three decades, from 1966 to 1998. Later, our third president, President Abdurrahman Wahid, failed to control the assembly and was impeached just 2 years after he was elected by the assembly. At the time he was impeached, the rewriting of the constitution has not been completed. Indeed, the original system was very unstable, unless if it was supported by a single party system or implemented in authoritarian way. Before going further, I would like to describe the features of Indonesia. As we can see from this map, it has over 250 million people. Maybe that was last year. Now it's maybe around 260 million people. Its territory comprises more than 13,400 islands during the high tides. In the low tides, maybe it's more than 16,000. And which are inhabited by more than 1,100 tribes. I have 1,100 tribes here, which speaks more than 700 active languages and dialects. It takes up to 7 hours of jet flying time from the western tip to the eastern tip. So that's from where? Miami to?
Florida to Alaska.
It's stretched along the equator. So, yeah, all religions in the world exist in Indonesia. Larger, with Islam comprises 88% of the populations. I think that's more than 220 million people. Then Islam in Indonesia is the largest in the world, larger than all Muslim population in the Middle East combined together. That maybe most of you never heard about that. The largest tribe is the Javanese, which comprise of 41% of the population, and the Sundanese, 16%. These two tribes are from Java Island, but they never claim Javanese language, for instance, as the national language. But thanks to our founding fathers and founding mothers, we should not forget that we have founding mothers. This heterogeneous people, in the midst of the movement to break away from colonialism in the early 20th century, managed to mold our identity as one nation of Bhinneka Tunggal Ika. That's a Sanskrit word for unity in diversity. It's like pluribus et unum. On October 1928, the prominent figures of youth movement from all over the archipelago convened a youth congress in Batavia, and despite all of the differences, pledged that we are one nation with one motherland and one national language, Indonesia. This pledge, renowned as Youth Pledge, is the main foundation and the salient factors to the existence of a new nation, Indonesia. You know, Indonesia is a new state. It was not there before the proclamation, and it's a new nation. It was not there before this Youth Pledge. So, Indonesian nationalism has been developing as an inclusive nationalism. despite of its heterogeneity, the people of Indonesia perceive itself as one nation, which is united by the shared dream of the just and prosperous future, a demos type people. Indonesia's unity is not based on tribe or religion or on other primordial sentiments. As I have mentioned before, all main religions of the world, Islam, Christianity, including Catholics, Buddhism, Hinduism, and others, and traditional beliefs are here in Indonesia. Hinduism began to spread in Indonesia in the first century, and Buddhism in the second century. As far as early 7th century, Nestorian Christian had its settlement in Barus, the large island in the left, the northern part. Nestorian Christian had its settlement there, the western coast of North Sumatra, a harbor of area which produces camphor and myrrh, used by civilization as old as ancient Egypt. It seems that the trading had been in place much earlier. In 16th century, Portuguese spread Catholicism in eastern Indonesia. That's to the eastern part below. Since 12th century, Islam was introduced and spread in peaceful approach by the Sufi peripatetic teachers come traders from Arab Peninsula. Since then, Islam spread as a moderate and middle path Islam, or also known as Wasatiyah Islam, that has a strong traditions of inclusiveness, tolerance, and peaceful coexistence with adherents of other religions. It provides, for instance, greater freedom to Muslim women in religious, social, cultural, and political lives. In Azra's word, one of the professors of the State Islamic University, Indonesian Islam is the least Arabicized Muslim, but not less Islamic. In general, this moderate Islam belongs either to Nahdlatul Ulama, the house of the awakening scholars, or to Muhammadiyah, the two largest Islamic organizations in Indonesia, even in the world. NU has about 50 million members. Muhammadiyah is about 40 million members. Thus, this the inclusive nationalism that I mentioned before and the moderate and tolerant Islam are the two main important factors that shape the characteristic of Indonesian politics. Aspiration for democratic constitution had been evolving since its making in 1945. Prominent members of the investigating commission had tried to include principles of rule of law, adhere to basic rights, you know, years before the Declaration of Human Rights in 1948. This is in 1945. People's sovereignty, but to no avail. Subsequently, the later generation continues the effort. However, there were also attempts to make Indonesia an Islamic state, or at least have to have Islamic nuance. During the making of the original constitution, there were proposals to make Islam as the foundation of the state, or Islam as the state religion, or that the president should be a Muslim, or that the state should require the adherent of Islam to implement Islam Sharia. All but one of these proposals could be canceled by deliberation during the process, except the last one, that's the requirement that the Islam should implement Islamic Sharia. A clause in first of the old constitution, the draft, which says that with obligation to implement Sharia Islam to its followers. This was the only one that debated until the final session of the committee in 1945. But especially during the due to a threat from the eastern part of Indonesia, that part to the right, to secede from the newly born Indonesia if the Sharia Islam is obliged, Muhammad Hatta persuaded the prominent Islamic figures in the committee to drop the clause, and they agree. Later, various groups strove again to make Islam a state foundation, either through democratic way, as was attempted by Islamic political parties such as Masyumi during the Constitutional Assembly in 1956-59, or through armed and bloody rebellion. Between 1949-62, Darul Islam waged a war of rebellions in West Java, Central Java, South Sulawesi, South Kalimantan, and lasted quite long, and also in Aceh, to establish an Islamic state in Indonesia. In Aceh, it lasted until 2004, and it's only tsunami, the intervention of tsunami, that brought the opportunity for peaceful approach. In 1998, Suharto had been in power for 32 years continuously. Born in 1921, he had been 77 years old. This five-star great general was a kind of liberation army, the Praetorian officers, who voluntarily fought for the country. All his comrades had retired, including all the young revolutionaries of 17 years old in the beginning of the revolution in 1945. Years before, in many occasions, he disclosed, including to me, his intention for a new civil supremacy political system, though that was still based on the original constitution. At the time, I was the head of the political section of the powerful supervisory board, which is formulate all the political policies at that time. He envisaged a strong civilian Golkar as dominating political power to ensure the stability of the system and the sustainability of development. Yeah, he is a kind of developmentalist general. Suharto also assigned scholars from Indonesian Institute of Sciences to study the future role of the armed forces, the military, in Indonesian politics. So he have this, you know, intention for a new civil supremacy system. Later, military commander General Wiranto set out a team led by the then fifth president, Susilo Bambang Yudhoyono, to formulate the main ideas on reform of the military. Along with this intention, discourses regarding the new civil supremacy system, along with other reformation issues, were flourishing in the society, including among the power elites and in the military. However, not all in his camp supported the idea. So there were groups of people who are longing for constitutional democracy, both in the society, in the university, among the students, and even among the elites. On the other hand, a massive educational programs implemented by President Suharto since 1970s, a program that generated well-educated peoples that became the critical element to his leadership, had also brought so many interesting things. Under the supervision of the Ministry of Religious Affairs, a large number of educational institutions were established that promoting the non-ideological concept of Islam. The State Institute for Islamic Studies, and especially its postgraduate program in Jakarta and Yogyakarta, and some of the students were sent to Chicago or to Hartford or to wherever, and especially its postgraduate program in Jakarta and Yogyakarta, played the key roles in New Order policy of promoting a modern non-ideological conception of Islam. It has brought about great changes in traditional Muslim communities. A new generation of political Islam was born. Many of them became the new elite Indonesia, which gives a new twist in the relationship of Islam and the state. they developed the notion that Islam and the Pancasila, the five principles, was not opposed. Pancasila as the state ideology is acceptable and has been final, and Indonesia shall not become an Islamic state. The actual challenge, they concluded, is how to realize the values of that state ideology into instrumental policies in various fields. It was a huge shoot of Islamic intellectuals who have a new way of thinking about philosophy of the country. Most of them belong to either the NU or the Muhammadiyah, the two largest Islamic organizations in Indonesia. Nur Kholis Majid is one of the major pioneers who asserted that Muslims do not need to dream to make Indonesia an Islamic state. Majid welcomes the general trend toward national convergence that evolving around the noble values of Pancasila. Majid asserted that Pancasila is sufficient to accommodate the aspiration of Muslims. Abdul Rahman Wahid, former chairman of this largest Islam organization, Nahdlatul Ulama, and he was the fourth Indonesian president, asserted that Islamic State is just an illusion that has no Islamic teaching basis. On the other hand, Ahmad Shafi'i Ma'arif, a prominent Islam reformist and former chairman of the second largest Muhammadiyah, affirms that actually, with the acceptance of the five principles of state philosophy by the majority of new generation of the santri, of the student of Islamic school system, then wide opportunities to build this nation open without bickering about theological philosophy. Rois A'am, the supreme advisor of the Nahdlatul Ulama, the largest Islamic organization in Indonesia, Sahal Mahfud, Kiai Haji Sahal Mahfud, reiterated that given the objective condition of the Indonesian nation that is ordained by God with a pluralistic population and society, NU, Nahdlatul Ulama, has concluded that the unitary state of Indonesia on the basis of the five principles is already the final form for Indonesian nation. Besides, there are also other prominent Islamic scholars, such as Alwi Shihab, former foreign minister, and he is now special envoy of the president to the OIC, Organization of Islamic Countries, and to the Middle East. Azumardi Asra, the former president of Islamic State University in Jakarta, and Amin Abdullah, former president of Islamic State University in Yogyakarta, and others who are striving to disseminate and to consolidate the inclusive middle path Islam. In December 1990, with blessing from President Suharto at the time, Association of Indonesian Muslim Intellectuals was founded, and Habibi, who later became the third Indonesian president, was elected as the chairman. It becomes a venue for the new Muslim elites, where the modernist and the traditionalist mix to enter into the elites of Indonesia. As admitted by Nur Kholis Majid, it eased the feeling of being outsider, and according to Jalaluddin Rahmat, a sense of returning power for the Muslim. In the meantime, efforts to build interfaith communications arose, initiated by figures such as Mukti Ali and Munawir Sadzali of Islam, both are former Ministry of Religious Affairs, and T.B. Simatupang, he was general and was the first, was the second commander-in-chief of Indonesian Armed Forces, Latwi Hamalo, and Franz Magni Suseno of Christian Catholic. Interfaith dialogues were organized together with other religions and set of beliefs, with major implication for the establishment of mutual understanding and cooperation among the various religions' followers, at least among the elites. This new perception is of great influence among Muslim intellectuals in general, which, as Kahin said, distinguished them from the older Muslim intellectual generations. It subsequently renders to the unanimous acceptance to the Pancasila, the five principles, and the preamble of the Constitution as the starting position of the constitutional reform in 1999, and had prevented the reform from failure, the same fate of the previous constituante process. Yet, it should be noted that besides them, also exist groups of Muslims who remain adamant to strive for Indonesia as an Islamic state, or at least that the implementation of Islamic Sharia shall be an obligation by constitution. With the rise of democracy, they have much more freedom to express their political ideologies and to develop their organizations. Lately, this group quite developed among the leading universities in Indonesia, as also in number of mosques, but not in the State Islamic University. Rewriting the original constitution. So during the political upheaval at the end of 1990s, besides demanded Suharto, President Suharto to resign, demonstrator also demanded democratization and an end to military involvement in politics. After Suharto resigned and Habibie sworn in as the new president, the assembly convened a special session and it decided, among others, to expedite the scheduled 2002 election to earlier to 1999, to liberalize the establishment of new political parties and to annul laws that hinder changes to the constitution. Thus, the election was held on June 7, 1999, and I, as a representative of one of the political parties, was elected as chairman of this Indonesia Election Commission in 1999, the first democratic election. 48 political parties, 45 of them new, contested in the election, monitored by domestic and international observers, including President Carter of the United States, who led observers from Carter Center. The election was successfully conducted and recognized as democratic and accountable, transparent. So the new political parties win the seat and the old political parties come as the second. Then the new assembly was formed. It could be noted that besides the old Islamic political parties, the new political parties with some sort of aspiration of Islamic politics, such as the Moon and Crescent Party, the new Masyumi, and Abuya parties did not perform as they expected. So in a democratic election, they cannot perform as expected. Subsequently, the seven political parties that won the most seats, together with the armed forces, reached an agreement to democratize the 1945 constitution through constitutional way, with a condition to maintain the preamble, the unitary form of the Republic of Indonesia, and to maintain the presidential system. And to that agreement, the armed forces pledged they will obey and submit to the constitution. That's one of the most important factors also. With this agreement, the roadmap for reforming the constitution was laid down and the new assembly convened a general session in October 1999. Later, in the beginning of 1999 general session, the political factions in the parliament reaffirmed those agreements and agreed to democratize our constitution constitutionally through amendment as stipulated by the constitution, not for making a new constitution. As I mentioned before, it could have been different if the existing constitution was not a respected and adhered constitution, such in case of changes of the 1983 South Africa Constitution in 1996 and the 1973 Philippines Constitution in 1988. Both were hated constitution. The process was based on the article in the Constitution which regulate the process, a provision which is quite rare in the constitution of the countries in the world. Usually, if one would like to change the constitution, they should go outside the system, outside the constitution, like in a revolution way. But in our case, we have the stipulation, the provision to do that. Because at the last time of the last moment of before ratification of our constitution back in 1945, no time to cleanse the original ones from the tainted ideas of fascists. So let's make it later, and then we have this provision. Based on the assembly's procedures, the meeting should emphasize deliberation and consensus. Only if the decisions are generally needed, so we can also do that, while the time is limited, decision by voting can be exercised. Actually, we can also, you know, taking voting. In accordance with the assembly procedures, an ad hoc committee was established to prepare the draft of amendment. And I, as a, one of the senior in the largest political party at the time, was then elected as the chairman of this process. It is worth noted that the assembly, we did not prepare academic draft for the changes. Every faction, big or small, had opportunities to submit any proposal they deemed necessary to reform the constitution. You can imagine how it like just like flea markets. What was obvious was the spirit for reform that had overwhelmed most members of the assembly and the intellectual public, so that popular terminologies such as people's sovereignty, rule of law, separation of power, checks and balances, independent judiciary power, and so forth, has become like a charm which were very familiar to everyone, notwithstanding that to some extent with different comprehension on its underlying concepts. In that regard for the faction, the text of the initial, the original constitution and the desire to democratize it were sufficient to guide the process. Thereby, while reaffirming their commitment to democratize the constitution based on their respective political insights and the aspiration of their constituent or the ideas they deem important in public's eye, their political parties, the faction had proposed whatever ideas they deemed necessary to improve the constitution. Subsequently, this proposal they submitted were compiled to become the base material of the improvement of the constitution. This situation had built a sense of ownership. This is the most important factor, and commitment of all factions in the assembly to the amendment process and to accomplish the amendment which the faction had perceived as their shared duty. Furthermore, the implementation of deliberation and consensus approach instead of majority-minority approach in decision-making, winner-takes-all process, although had caused the process prolonged and rambled, had made every faction, small or big, saw themselves as contributive actors in the process. Thus, since the beginning, the faction had considered amendment of the Constitution as their own obligation, and with that, an attitude that ensured the reform would work, which was seminal for the subsequent establishment of symbiotic relationship between the Constitution and its practices. It would be different if the faction had to deal with an academic draft that had been prepared in advance, to which they had to give response to something that already had fixed shapes. Moreover, if the faction only had the option to accept or to reject the draft, it sometimes happens in other countries. Perhaps that way could produce a better composed or better written constitution and could be completed more rapidly. But certainly that process could not build support and sense of commitment from the political public to the constitution. Other than that, this process was a political process that should resonate with the real challenges in the society. Through various programs such as public hearings, seminars, workshops, and comparative studies we organized both in Jakarta and the provinces, we reached and interacted with the problems and the political challenges evident in society. Thus, for example, during the debates of the position of Islamic Sharia in state affairs, a People's Congress was held in North Sulawesi, that is majority Christian, and they proclaimed to secede from Indonesia if the state obliges the implementation of Islamic Sharia. A seminar we held in Pekanbaru, in the Sumatra Island, a province which is rich with oil and gas, the Stanfac was there, the Caltex was there, was attended by participants who claimed themselves as representatives of the Free Riau, including their presidential candidate, who demanded separation. The same also happened in Jayapura, Papua. A statement from certain groups in East Kalimantan also talked about Free East Kalimantan. They reacted to the debates regarding the unhealthy relationship between the center and the peripheries in the unitary state of Indonesia. The above records disclose that the public was willing to express their aspiration and their disappointment or even their anger frankly and openly to the constituted state forum. Thereby, the process interacted with sensitive issues in Indonesian politics, in which the reform of the constitution was also an attempt to resolve the challenges. Indeed, the process should not be sterile from, but should be in discourses with the immediate political challenges the state is encountering, not just the process of designing a system based on theoretical principles. Reforming the constitution in a way of stealing a chance and by applying majority-minority approach, take it or leave it approach, might have produced a textually good constitution, but it does not guarantee that the constitution will be adhered. In certain circumstances, such an approach can even lead to cleavage of a state, such as experienced by some countries during reformation process. On the other hand, the minutes of the discussions of the amendment process in the assembly reveals that, at least initially, the faction did not really aware the scale of the necessary revisions to the original constitution and how far the amendment would alter the principle in its articles. No one had a comprehensive view of how the 1945 constitution be look like after amendment. It is also worth noting that, at least until the second amendment, most of the factions were still very much seized by the notion that the assembly, the Supreme Assembly, was the highest political institution which manifests and implements the sovereignty in full, the people's sovereignty in full, as stipulated in the original constitution. The constitution also disclosed that actually academic communities, the professors, and the political public at large did not have clear attitudes and opinions regarding the scope of the reforms to the constitution and to what extent the principles of the original one, should be revised. Basically, the process was open to public and broadcasted real time. The meeting of the ad hoc committee were attended by students, researchers, NGOs, both domestic and international, journalists, and others. We also invited professors from the United States, from South Africa, from Germany, from France, to give their input. Gradually, with input from the public hearings, seminars, comparative studies, considering the opinion evolving in a society, and with the help of experts, members of committee discussed and drafted the most acceptable changes to democratize the constitution. Occasionally, the process was interspersed by informal consultation, lobbyings between the leadership of the committee or the factions or the political parties to overcome problems and hindrances. At the end of the discussion, usually we form a small team for drafting the changes which were then submitted to the plenary for approval. Thus, the changes are not grafted or copy-pasted materials supplied by others, as is often claimed or alleged by various parties. In this kind of process, which emphasizing deliberation and informal consultation, good personal relationship was important. Being in the leadership of the student demonstration back in 1966, and also members of parliament for 34 years, from 1968 to 1997 and 1999 to 2004. So far, I am the longest in Indonesian history. I was in the elite of the ruling party at the Suharto's time, and also the elite in the later political parties, dominant political parties, a dissident politicians in 1993 to 1997, and as the chairman of the election commission in 1999, I have these opportunities to know the elites of the political spheres from various era. This had helped me significantly in forming personal friendship with political activists and elites, which was very helpful in leading the amendment process. Yeah, I was a student for architectural engineering before, but I failed to complete it because I, you know, just involved in this politics. Yeah, but later I studied public administration, and later I get my master's degree from Harvard University. And with that in the background, let us look how changes had been made as depicted, among others, in on the following topics, just selected topics. Reforming the Supreme People Consultative Assembly. In the original constitution, the assembly was the heart of the system, which makes it authoritarian in nature. This assembly was considered as the personification, reincarnation of the people, which implemented the people's sovereignty in full. Its authority was unlimited, and according to its original intent, its members were representatives of a single state political party, augmented with appointed delegates from the provinces and the functional groups. It had authority, among others, to elect the president, to ask accountabilities of the president, the House of Representatives, the Supreme Court, and other state high constitution institutions. However, because the reform process was conducted by this supreme body, so it was conducted by this supreme body, and this assembly had been in place for more than three decades. At the outset, initially, most of the factions still perceived that to strengthen the people's sovereignty should mean to strengthen the power of this Supreme Assembly. In that regard, initially, the military and police factions and elements of several other factions tried to maintain the presence of appointed member of assembly from the functional groups, including from the armed forces. So it's a very strategic position. Therefore, we did not attempt to directly change the assembly as a whole. Instead, we approached the reform from the sides. It's like eating the hot porridge. We eat it from the periphery. slowly to the center. One by one of its authorities, such as to elect the president, to ask the accountabilities of people, direct elected president and the House of Representatives, the accountabilities of the independent judicial body, were revoked. Thus, eventually, we could reach agreement that assembly should have only certain and limited authorities, because no more left, so as to change and to enact the constitution to elect the president or the vice president in an emergency situation. At this process took 3 years, bit by bit, point by point, to achieve that reforms. So not a one single shot. It's slowly and we should be very patient and persistent and consistent to do that. However, regarding the appointed members of the assembly, eventually the decision could only be decided by voting in the last session. This is the only decision that taken by voting of the assembly in year 2002. Quite a number from the faction, including my political parties and from other parties, voted against the abolishment of these appointed members. But it should be noted that all members of the military faction voted for an end of the appointed members. Thus, the involvement of the military in politics ended. Thereby, a new verse that affirms that sovereignty shall be vested in the hands of the people and be executed according to the constitution was incorporated in the constitution. With their changes, constitution is enthroned as the supreme law of the land, to which the popular sovereignty is subjugated, and a mechanism of check and balances which was absent with the existence of a supreme state institution was established. It worth noting that the Supreme Assembly eventually had abolished its supreme authorities voluntarily and the throne itself. Years later, some of the members, feel very sorry that they have taken out that supreme power. Rule of law. Rule of law was one of the important topics discussed during the process. It had been raised since the beginning of the process in 1999, but we concluded not to hastily assert it in the Constitution until its basic principles, such as adherence to human rights, religious freedoms, independent judicial body, the supremacy of the Constitution, were confirmed. Provision on that, on human rights, for instance, were stipulated during the second stage, and judiciary as an independent authority was confirmed in the third stage, and election on the also third stage, and so forth. And then we conclude that ultimately, after all the requirement fulfilled in the year 2001, we concluded to affirm that Indonesia is a state which is based on the rule of law. Hence, by claiming rule of law, it should be ultimate that the exercise of state power is curbed by law. Therefore, in a rule of law state, the people's elected government is subjugated to the law. On the human rights, a full set of provision of human rights was set up in the Constitution in the second stage of amendment, just 1 year after it began. Previously, the Assembly's special session had decided a decree regarding adherence to human rights. And during the amendment process, there was no serious debate regarding the substance of the principles. Factions reaffirmed their agreement to the principles and to improve the position of human rights from assembly decree to become constitutional law. Indeed, there was a proposal that Indonesia should combine the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, which is universal, with 1990 Cairo Declaration of Human Rights, which asserts that rights and freedoms should subject to Sharia Islam, which is particular. But other members of the committee argued that the human rights are universal, inherent in the humanity, not a gift from the state. They are the basic rights which are qudratia in Islamic view, natural gift of God, and fitria, disposition of human beings. And what the state should do is to recognize and to guarantee the rights. Another issue was regarding the right to convert, which was actually discussed informally. The committee agreed that it had been included in the stipulation which affirms that every person shall be free to embrace a religion as stipulated in the articles, and that the right of religion is one of the human rights that cannot be reduced under any circumstances whatsoever, a non-derogable rights. Based on this principle of human rights, for instance, the committee agreed to change the requirement of a president. Historically, there was argument that the president of Indonesia should be a native of Indonesia and a Muslim. But the original constitution stipulates that the president should be a native, so Muslim is not a requirement. However, eventually, during this process, it was concluded that it is sufficient that a president shall be an Indonesian citizen as of his or her birth and shall never accept other citizenship due to his or her own accord. This is the rather sensitive issue, religion and state. During the 4 years amendment process, there was no proposal or effort to make Islam as the state foundation, or to make Islam as the state religion. All factions affirmed that they did not only accept Pancasila as the foundation of the state, but asserted that Pancasila, as embodied in the preamble, must be adhered and maintained as the foundation of the state. The debate had shifted to how the role of the state in religious affairs should be, especially Islam, and what is the role of religions in the making of state policies in a state that based on Pancasila with belief in oneness of Almighty God as the first principle. From the second state, the Islamic faction had been adamant to reinstate the clause, belief in one God, with obligation to implement Sharia Islam to its followers after the prayers. This is an issue that renowned as the issue of seven words. It's Indonesian language, it consists of seven words. On the other hand, the Islamic faction also proposed that article on national education should stipulate that education should enhance faithfulness, devoutness, as well as noble characters. However, although by number the proponents of the seven words clause was much smaller than the opponents, we intentionally did not want to take decision by voting. Eventually, in an informal consultation, the Islamic faction agreed not to hinder the assembly to maintain the original article with condition that their proposal regarding the education system should be accepted. Other factions did not oppose the proposal in education on the basis that what was proposed was regarding the values of religions, not the literal rules of the religions. Thus, the proponents of seven words allowed the plenary to conclude to maintain the original Article 29, but they asserted not to withdraw their proposal to insert the seven words, and although they attended, the plenary would not participate in the decision-making process. On the other hand, they affirm that the plenary decision is legitimate and binding on all parties, including on themselves. It's quite. Furthermore, the Islamic faction asserted that they will continue striving for this issue in the future democratically. Intentionally, we did the deliberation openly so that the people at large can follow and learn from the process. Those small faction which propose that can see that their proposal is not just neglected or ignored. It has been debated, discussed. But they can see that most of others couldn't agree with that. We do not take decision by voting in order not to inflict wounds in the heart of the people who support the idea. Therefore, despite that MPR, the Assembly formally and legally had decided to retain the original article, yet disagreement over the fundamental of the issue was not solved at all at once, but become a part that should be answered by the process of social changes brought forward by development. So the success of democratization of the Constitution of Indonesia is due to several factors. The process was carried out constitutionally and undertaken by constitutional institutions. The process was not concluded in haste and not by a majority takes all approach, but by way of deliberation and consensus. So it had cultivated sense of ownership and commitment for its success amongst the actors. The absence of academic draft and the opportunity to propose change deemed necessary had added to the sense of ownership and commitment for the success. In the background, in the backdrop, there was a successful election preceded the process, the strong aspiration for democracy among the people, the reform-minded people both in the government and the armed forces and the opposition who could achieve agreement to democratize the country in the constitutional way. All of above was supported by the inclusive Indonesian nationalism, unity in diversity, Bhinneka Tunggal Ika, and the existence of the moderate and middle path Islam as the mainstream Islam in Indonesia. In that regard, the process of the making of the constitution is not always and not necessarily similar from one country to another. In the making of a democratic constitution, the main thing is to find the formulas of the immutable principles of a democratic constitution that can be agreed upon rather than to impose a formula that is used elsewhere. Constitution making is a political process and political decision making is a political art. Usually, constitutional changes happen in the midst of reality of the political challenges and should be in interaction with the challenges. Therefore, the process should also be part of efforts to prevent the challenges to become unmanageable and to find solutions to the challenges facing the nation. Thus, the process of constitutional change is also an instrument for conflict resolution and reconciliation. Therefore, whether a constitution can serve as prescription for the state to deal with its challenges is not only determined by the provision of the constitution, but also entrenched on how a constitution has been made. The reform constitution is not an end goal by itself. For Indonesia, with its diverse society, with its daily life is very much influenced by diversity of norms and religious teachings, whereas the society always changing, the society as a whole cannot be assumed as being ready to follow all the principles in the constitution. For Indonesia, the ideal goal we want to realize are in the preamble, like the Declaration of Independence for the US people, which is an asymptotic goal on the horizon, the ideas that can never be achieved, but can be approached. Thus, the amended constitution will serve as an instrument and guidelines for social changes and to navigate to the desired ideals. This approach requires space for deliberation, an atmosphere for mutual respect, and even friendly relation amongst the leaders. Ultimately, there is no perfect constitution, and the amended 95 constitution should be a living constitution that could always be improved. Thank you.
Yes.
Ambassador Tobing has agreed to take some questions. Any questions from the audience? Yes, right here. Please stand up. There's a microphone, I think.
Thank you. How helpful was religion as an institution in this process? The institution of religion in your country, how helpful was it in leading you to a state of democracy?
The religions.
Catholicism, for example.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, as I mentioned, no serious challenges to the principles of democracy raised during the process. That's because of the most influential part of the society, and the Islam, is moderate. There are other strain of Islam, I must say. In their own words, this is the least Arabicized Islam, which tried to take out of this political conflicts in that area in the Middle East into the Islam, but not less Islamic. So if I can borrow their words, this is one factor. So when we talk about human rights, for instance, freedom of religions, they just say, that's not a gift from the state. It's from the God. And I said, Imago Dei. Christian or a Catholic or an Islam is an Imago Dei. For them, the same thing. So that's why we do not have. But I should admit, lately, the influence of the radicals try to, they have achieved some footprints on that. And, in the committee, yes?
Is the United States helping you with that process?
I'm going to restrict it just because there may be others. Okay. Yes, back here.
Hi, my name is John. I'm a fourth year here. Thank you for coming. My name is John, and I'm a fourth year, but thank you for coming and speaking. I wanted to ask if there was ever a point in the process, especially in the late 90s, where you doubted the success of your mission, or you doubted what was going to happen. And I guess in a broader sense, is there a point where people doubt democracy can work in countries like this, and maybe it can't work? So, because that's like a common thing, I think.
Was there any point in the 1990s when you doubted the success of democratization in Indonesia?
Oh, yes. Yeah. This is not the something that you just grab it from the air. There were, those who opposed it, as I mentioned. Not all in the military, not all in the political parties can accept the reform process. For instance, my own political parties, it was originally, inspired by the first president Sukarno. To some of them, especially the old guards, they perceived the original one, which is authoritarian, is the legacy of the first president. The chairwoman of the political party is the daughter of the president Sukarno, so it's like an odd position. And the chairman of the political party, Megawati, said, okay, but I think it's now we are approaching 21st century. This opinion belongs to the 1930s. Let's have a new one. So then, we move on. And I took initiative like this. We have in my political parties, there were about 20 people in this committee, or no, less than that, about maybe 16 people. And I divided into two to have a simulation. The first one was assigned to draft the most conservative, and the other one the most reformist, but still in the platform of the political parties. And we have this serious debates. After that, we can have a very, very, you know, we can lead the situation because we are prepared. And as I mentioned later, when we tried to have agreement on the position of the People's Assembly, many of our parties voted against the reform, as well as many from other parties. They are outnumbered, but more than 100. But the military, they said, we should have a new system. Maybe they think with the assembly with less power, why should us be with that, and we can become the target of the just people cursing us, something like that.
Yes, I wanted to know the reason your identity cards name the religion on it, and doesn't that create discrimination? The identity cards in Indonesia list on your identity card your religion, whether you're Muslim or Catholic or Buddhist. Why? And doesn't that create some problems?
Yeah. Yes, that's true. I have in my ID religions, Christian. There are argument for that, both principle and practice. If something happens to you in the street, how we should take care of you? We should know your like religions, and while we cannot ask you, so we can see it from your ID. That's a practical reason behind it. But the more fundamental reason is that we are not a confessional state, but not a secular state. So we should know his faith in order how we can respect him. Yeah, you can see it from other side, but we can have this side also. Yeah.
Another question.
Okay.
All right.
Okay.
Please join me in thanking Ambassador.